Average centipawn loss is a value which indicates the precision of your moves. So the lower the value it is more precise that you have played the game. And if it's higher the value, which means you have played the game not as precise as a Stockfish engine would have preferred it to be. So let me take you through this game, which was pretty good. Average centipawn loss of 10 is always nice. And it was against a 2000 rated player. Similar ratings for both of me and the opponent, and it went pretty well. So I hope it's instructive and you watch it till the end. And if you do like it, please do subscribe to my channel as well. Otherwise, it's okay, you don't. But if you do like it, please, you will subscribe, right? All right, let's begin with this game. It starts off with d4. Opponent responds with d5. I'll turn on the analysis as well. And now I played a bishop to g5. Levitsky attack, it's always nice to play it. I'll just open the opening reference as well. It is the Levitsky attack, as I said. When you play bishop to g5 early, that indicates that you are pressurizing opponent to play either h6 or at least prevent the opponent from playing e6 straight away. Because you're eyeing this diagonal, it is always nice. And when we move on from here, opponent starts off with knight to f6 here. I go with e3. Opponent plays bishop to f5, and I can take now the knight, and the opponent can also take back with either of the pawns. The problem is opponent will have double pawns, and opponent can get rid of this pin as soon as possible. But I didn't take here. I went with continuation of knight to f3. Opponent goes with c6, allows me to play bishop d3. I'm offering a bishop trade. Opponent does take, and after I take, if you see, I have three pieces developed. Opponent has got one only. So that is the plus point of trading of the bishop there. I took off the developed piece from the opponent. Opponent plays knight to d7 now. I play knight to d2. Opponent goes for h6, trying to kick the bishop backwards. I go on h4 with the bishop, not a problem. I can still maintain that annoying bishop towards the queen side. Opponent plays e6 finally. I play c3, opponent goes with bishop e7, and here I bring back my bishop onto g3. I'm okay because next time I was expecting opponent to play knight to e4, which will have a discover attack on my bishop, which is defended once with the knight, but opponent has two pieces attacking it. So rather I'll just move my bishop. I don't want to give my bishop. I just got it back, and now opponent can do whatever. Even if knight comes in, I take the knight. Opponent takes back with the pawn, and I take the extra pawn as well with my queen. So I'm pretty happy with this position. So this doesn't go well for the opponent. Opponent decides to now castle on the king side. I went with a knight to e5, the controlling square, centralized square for the knight, which can now attack the knight as well. So opponent decided to take here, and I can take with the bishop or the pawn. But in this position, I chose to take with the pawn. Just like in the London system, it's preferred to take with the pawn. My idea was even if the knight goes back to d7, which in the game does happen, there's not a problem. And I can play f4 as well, which is aggressive. I'm trying to go for pawn break maybe next. I can take back with the queen. I can still castle king side or queen side. Anything is fine. And I'll have good attack going on. Opponent counters attack with the with f5, which allows me to take the pawn now with en passant. Opponent takes back with the bishop, and here I castle on the king side itself. I'm okay because rooks will be in front of each other. Opponent goes for e5 pawn break. I take here. Opponent takes back with the bishop. Now I take off the rook first. Opponent takes back with the queen. I take the bishop, which now opponent takes with the knight, and here comes queen to d4, attacking the knight now. So all the trades have happened. We are closing in on the end game now. We'll be reaching the end game stage. The middle game is almost over on from here. Queen to e7 by opponent, defending the knight. And here comes a rook in the open file, rook to f1. Opponent plays knight to g4, trying to grab the extra pawn, but forgets that the knight is hanging. And maybe the opponent had something else in mind as well, which I'll just tell you after this. Next move, opponent takes the pawn with a check. So opponent thought, after opponent takes the pawn, I will move aside and opponent can take the knight, and that would be handy for the opponent. But here comes the game changer. because the opponent was greedy for the extra pawn, I went with rook to f2 here, which defends my knight. Opponent can just give me one more check maybe, but then I can save with the knight as well. So knight is defended, my rook is already defended, so not an issue at all. So suddenly game changes due to the sacrifice which my opponent does, trying to be greedy for an extra pawn, which doesn't work out. Now comes rook to f8, trying to exchange the rooks. And again, the best move as per the computer was played by me, which was queen to e2, which defends my rook again, which was now attacked twice. So I have defended it twice, so I'm pretty good with it. And now opponent has nothing but just to hold on to the diagonal, going back with the queen to b6. I played b4 here, defending the pawn. You don't want to lose pawns anyhow, you no matter how much up you are. And now opponent plays queen to d4, which was sad because I have a check coming from multiple places. And then this rook will be going down as well. And queen has already blocked the diagonal by placing pawn forward. So it's completely winning from here, and opponent resigns on the 24th move. I hope you enjoyed the video. And as I asked you earlier, if you do like it, please do subscribe it. And I shall see you tomorrow with some interesting and instructive content like always. Thanks for watching. Take care. Bye-bye.